Well, there's no one else in the world like you.
Amen.
And God made it that
way.
You may not always get the attention that you deserve, but do know that God intends for you
to be who you are. And you are doing just what He intends for you to do.
I'm going to share with you this morning a scripture, and it's taken from the second chapter of Luke. The second chapter of Luke. And I'm going to read from the 16th through the 19th verse. Before I begin, I do want to make mention that we, as a result of the gifts that have been received for our 10-year church celebration, we've made a couple of enhancements to our service. We have all wireless mics now. This is the first Sunday where we've had everything on, and so we may have a little humming going on, but we're going to get it together. And also, hopefully, I pray that you notice when you came into the sanctuary this morning, we have those beautiful decorative vases. You may not have noticed, and that's not all bad, because they weren't intended to draw attention to themselves, they were intended to beautify the surroundings. But now that I've mentioned it, you will certainly notice. And we were here yesterday for the church cleanup, and all the people that were here did a marvelous job. And part of what you are experiencing today is the result of the labor yesterday. And the beauty that you will see as you walk out the sanctuary this morning and the mornings to come is a reminder of the beauty of God. The things that God has given to us to enjoy this life that He's given to us. I want to thank those who are giving for our 10-year restoration. There are other things that we would like to do and we will do as those pledges come forward, those special pledges. There's a few other enhancements, but truly God is blessing. See the faith, and you are able this morning to experience some of that. Let's give God the glory. I'd like for you to take your Bible in your hand, and what we do every Sunday is to make certain that we honor God with His Word, because we put His Word first. If we order our steps according to His Word, we will not stumble and we will not fail. If we hide His Word in our heart, we will not sin. And so each Sunday we take this Word for what it is. It is the living Word of God. And we pledge to it. So if you would please, if you hold your Bible up, we're going to say our pledge together. I pledge allegiance to Thy Bible, God's holy word. I will make a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I will hide His words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Amen.
Amen.
Mothers, you are so special. Go now to the Word of God, verse number 16 through 19, second chapter of St. Luke, and it says, "And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. See, there's a difference between how our mother sees things and how everybody else sees things. So this morning I want to just share with you some secrets. The secrets mother never told you. The secrets your mother never told you. The secrets your mother never told you. I'm imagining, except for those of you that have been on this journey a long time, and even those that have as mothers, you sometimes look back, I'm sure, over your life and you say, I don't know how my mother used to do this. I don't know how you all do what you do. Even those who are experienced often express the uncertainty of how in this day and age a person can be all that you are and still keep going. You endure so much more than the average person would seemingly be designed to be able to do. And in our text this morning, one of the things that stands out to me is how when other people are wondering, as it says in verse number 18, and they that heard wondered at those things, other people who don't sit in your seat, don't walk in your shoes, mother, we all wonder, how do you do it? But yet, the secret that you haven't yet shared with so many of us is that it's not so much the things that you do, but it's what you have in your heart that makes the most difference. You see, others were perplexed and they wondered, but mothers remained devoted until the very end. Sometimes what you do is silent and nobody knows about it. Other times what you do brings attention because you want to make certain that no one does harm to what you love so dearly. A mother will go to great lengths to sacrifice her own so that the one that she loves can be cared for. In the text that I just read in verse number 19, in the King James Version, it says, Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. But when you look at the New International Version, the NIV, they translated that word ponder into a different word. In the NIV, it says, Mary treasured these things in her heart. In other words, the NIV makes clear that what it was that allowed Mary to be able to be who she was, because God made her that way, was not because of any sense of uncertainty or even wonder, but it's because of what she treasured. You see, mothers treasure their children. Mothers treasure their family. While others are pondering and wondering how it is that you have the stamina and the strength and the ability to be able to do what you do, mothers rejoice. Mothers are able to survive even when others would have given up a long time ago. Mothers have to put up with things that sometimes break their heart. But because of what they treasure, they still pick up the pieces, sometimes cracked, and they go on. Let me tell you something about the journey. This book, the Bible, has much in it. There's a verse in Proverbs, chapter number 10, and verse number 1, that speaks to this. In Proverbs, chapter number 10, and verse number 1, it says, a wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish son son is the heaviness of his mother. You see, the reality is, mothers hurt when we hurt. A mother hurts when her child is hurting. A mother knows, despite the good face, when something is wrong. I was listening several months ago to something that Sister Lysandra Barry said. I know she's like, you call my name now. I'm not going to make you stand, I'm just using your name. And it was in a setting, and it, you all got to be careful when you say things around the bishop, because I capture these things all the time. So this may have been 4 or 5 months ago. But she said something to the effect, I think she attributed to her mother. A mother is only as happy as her saddest child. Did I say that right? Okay. A mother cannot live in bliss when any one of her children is suffering. They hurt when you hurt. They succeed with you. And their journey is a journey that is connected to that of their children. So when we look at this text and we see that others pondered and wondered, we find out that a mother like Mary holds these things in her heart. To give special honor to mothers is to appreciate each one of you for the unique qualities that define motherhood. So throughout time, every mother has made a difference in the life of every child. Sometimes the memories that we have of our mothers are blurred, but the impact that they have on our life is real just the same. So what is your secret? How are you able to look frustration in the eye and keep on going? What makes you, Mom, able to stay up late, turn around and get up early? What's your secret, mothers? How are you capable of loving even that unlovable one and seeing positive things even in the most negative situations? God made you that way. How are you able to say just the right thing, just enough, right at the right time, when it seems like it makes all the difference? How are you able to take the onslaught of those childhood years during the teen years when the children want to pull away from everything that you do to embrace them, and yet you stand just the same? Well, I want to share with you in these few moments that we have this morning the secrets that your mother never told you. First thing I believe is that in order to be the kind of mother described in that video and the kind of mother that God intends for you to be as a woman of God, there are three important things that we need to take note of. First of all, it's what you see that makes the difference. First of all, it's what you see that makes the difference. Secondly, it's what you do that makes the difference. And thirdly, most importantly, it's what you feel that makes the difference. First of all, I want to share with you that it's what you see that makes the difference. There was an occasion in the book of John, chapter number 2, when this same woman, Mary, was at a wedding feast with her son, her oldest son, not her only son. This is a little Bible teaching. Jesus had brothers and sisters, so for those of you who try to convey that immaculate conception, Mary only had this one, no, that's not true. Jesus was her firstborn child, but not her only child. So when she was with her oldest child, Jesus, at a wedding feast on an occasion celebrating the wedding, and the Bible says clearly that the party was going on and there was no longer any wine in the room. In the second chapter of John, it describes that they came to Mary and said, there's no wine left in the room.
Right.
What Mary told the crowd was, I've got a son.
Right.
His name is Jesus.
Right.
And he is here.
Right.
And Jesus can do something about your situation.
Yes.
You see, the people who were around Mary on this occasion were much like the people who were there at his birth. They saw him, but yet they didn't really know him. They saw him, but they really didn't see him. But the mother, Mary, saw something in her child that nobody else could see. And when the time came for the miracle to happen, they came to Mary and said, Mary, what are we going to do? And Mary said, my son, he is here. You go over and you tell him about the situation, and whatever he tells you to do, if you want your problem fixed, you do it. So let me just say it one more time. When Jesus is around, whatever he tells you to do, if you want your problem fixed, you ought to do that. But you see, the key here is that Mary, being the mother, was able to see something in her son that nobody else could see. This is one of the secrets, I believe, to being the kind of mother that the Bible calls for. You see, whatever she's able to see is not always discerned with the natural eye. It's not always discerned with the natural eye, because there's something in your character, something in your nature, because she was there from the very beginning, that she's able to see that others cannot see. You see, being the mother that you are, even though they don't seem to act like it around other people, they don't need to say to you, I'm hurting, because you're the mother. You can see that hurt. And you know when your child is happy and excited, even though they may act like on the outside, oh, it's just another day. There's something that you're able to see that nobody else can see. So it was with Mary, even before Jesus began his ministry, before the angel, before came down upon him after he was baptized in the Jordan by his cousin John the Baptist, and the heavens opened up and God spoke and said, this is my son, hear him what he says. And the Holy Spirit came down as a dove upon his shoulder. You know the Bible, don't you? Before any of these things happened, when God through the Holy Spirit led Jesus up to the wilderness to be tempted of the devil, he's going to attack you. You know the Bible, don't you? Before his name was known throughout the region as the miracle worker, as the rabbi, as the Messiah. Before all of those things take place, his mother Mary said, I see something in you. I need to tell you this morning, there's a secret to being the mother that you are. You see something in every child. And I'm grateful. Even as I grew up, I had my siblings, and there were six of us. And it's amazing that even with the six of us, mother seemed to know individually and uniquely what each child needed. Let me just tell you something. A mother knows that to be fair with each child doesn't always mean that you treat them equally.
Right.
But you don't have to treat me equally
to
treat me the same.
Yes, sir.
You don't have to treat me equally to treat me the same. Let me give you an illustration. All right, if I thought this ahead, I'd have brought it with me. But let me just give it to you like this. Let's suppose you have a 1 gallon jug of milk, a milk cup that's empty, 1 gallon. And over here you have a 5 gallon paint container that's empty. 1 gallon, 5 gallons. And you want to treat them the same in that you want to fill them both up. I want to fill both of them up. I'm treating them the same. Now, to fill up this 1 gallon container, I'm going to put how much in it? I'm filling it up, right? To fill up this 5 gallon container, I'm going to put how much in it? Now, that's not equal, is it? But you don't have to be equal to be treated the same. You see, a mother knows that this child, I may need to put my hand on him to get him to learn something. This child over here could be like my daughter. If I just look at her with my good eye, cross-eyed, she would, oh, she's in the room. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Secrets mother never told us.
Right, right. No, no.
came into the world, your mother could see the kind of person that you were going to be. And she did everything she could to try to help to shape that outcome. But she knows some things about you that even you have yet to discover. I sometimes listen to young mothers even now who talk lovingly of the things that they see in their children. The child is 3 years old, 5 years old, barely able to spell their name. But yet the mother says, I see leadership in this child. She's not a follower, she's a leader. I see creativity in this child. So let me just suggest to you, the secret of a mother is that she sees through her heart. But it's not just the things that you see that matters, Mother. It's the things that you do. And here it's not talking so much about the quantity of the things that you do, but the quality. You see, this is a very similar discussion to the fact of being equal to the same. You see, some people think that if I buy more, that's going to make it better. No, it's not always in the quantity of what you give. See, ultimately, your time, face time, I'm not talking about the time. What did we used to say before we had these words? Face time used to mean real face-to-face time. Let me help somebody who's under 25. There was a time when somebody said, give me some FaceTime. Amen. Let's meet face to face, person to person. Now when you say, give me some FaceTime, okay, what's your number? That's right. That's right. The reality is it's not the quantity of what you do and what you give. It's the quality. See, today, mothers, you are pulled in how many different directions? Many. How many? You guys say, Bishop, how many directions are there? I'm pulled in every one of them. In some directions I'm pulled, I don't even know where to go. I don't know. As somebody used to say, I don't know whether I'm going or coming. I know one thing, though, I'm being pulled in both directions. So let me just suggest to you that even with all of the conflicting priorities that are present in every household today, mothers, even if you only have 5 minutes in a busy schedule. Now, some would argue, you got more than 5 minutes. You just need to go back through your calendar to make sure you prioritize. Well, I'm not going to go there, but you do have more than 5 minutes. But with all you have is 5 minutes to spend face time with your child. Make that time quality time. Because at the end of the day, when it's all over, and that child looks back at those days, it's those quality moments that will hold their heart when all the other distractions in life are trying to pull them right, left, up, down, sideways. It's what she does that makes all the difference in the world. Now understand this, limitations exist. There's another mother in Exodus chapter number 2 who happened to give birth to a famous prophet. In fact, he wasn't just an ordinary prophet. He was actually someone who God gave the privilege to see him in his person. Not to God's face, because no one can look at God's face and live. But he allowed this man to see God in his person. And in fact, he was someone that God cared so much about that God actually spent time communing with him. His name was Moses. Now, his mother gave birth to him. But because of the circumstances of the time, his mother could not care for him in the manner that she wished to. Because circumstances sometimes prevent you from all your desire to give the quantity of time. You are pulled by other responsibilities, some of which are beyond your control. Mother, don't allow anybody to tell you you're a bad mother because you don't have more time, or because your circumstances don't allow you to do more things. Don't allow anybody to make you believe that you are unfit because you're not able to heap upon your child everything that somebody else is able to do. You see, Moses' mother was faced with a set of circumstances that did not allow her to do what her heart wanted to do. So the Word of God says in the second chapter of Exodus that she nurtured him for as long as she could. And when she could not do it anymore for fear that Pharaoh would find the child and kill the child for the child's own sake, she wrapped him up, put him into a little ark, and put him upon the Nile River. And she watched helplessly as her loving son floated down the river. Believing in her heart that God would take care of the one she loved. She Mother, there are times when all you can do is to let go of the situation and trust that the God who gave him or her to you will take care of her or her, because they are beyond the point when you can do it for yourself. No one claims today that Moses' mother was an unfit mother. No one who reads the story and knows the circumstances would say she abandoned her child. But rather, we look at this woman who made the hard choice of saying, I'm going to do as much as I can while I can, wherever I can. And when the point in time comes that I can do no more, I love my son enough. And trust that the God who gave him to me will take care of
you. Yes.
You see, a real mother has secrets. And her secret is, not only do I see things that others can't see, but sometimes I have to do things that others don't understand. How many times, Mom, have others said you're crazy? I wouldn't do that. How many times, Mom, have others said you need to start thinking about yourself? How many times have others tried to give you advice about your child? They only know by name. Yet you've been there from the moment of birth until present. Sometimes mothers have to do things that others just don't understand. These are things No matter how bleak the situation, this mother recognized that there's always hope. And what I've done all I know how to do, I'm still going to trust God anyhow. Trying to juggle so many things, I'm just going to trust God anyhow. The child doesn't appreciate it, never says thank you, barely even speaks in the morning. Yet I'm going to trust God anyhow. This card, this plate. some point, somebody's got to take responsibility. If anything is going to happen, everybody can pass the buck. Somebody has to take a stand. If you see wrong, you can't just say it's somebody else's problem. At some point, you have to take a stand. If you see stuff dropped on the floor in the church, you can't just walk over it and assume somebody else is going to pick it up. Eventually, somebody has to say, this is my church too. I didn't drop it, and I don't care who did. I see it. It's on the ground. Let me pick it up, because I want to be an agent of positive change. I just don't want to pass the buck. And let me suggest to you that much of the trouble that we are experiencing in our communities today date back to the place where somewhere on the line we were all convinced that somebody else would fix it. There used to be a time, saints of God, a long time ago, when if children was acting up, my child was acting up, I didn't have to be there to know that if my child was telling, I'm not talking about this one, because this one was always good. They could have always told me. She didn't look that way, she was all right. But let me talk about somebody else's child. Let me just put it on myself. Used to be the time when I was growing up, when I was a child, my parents didn't have to be in the room if I cut up. I had all kinds of aunties and uncles and kinfolk and folk that wasn't related to me that was caring about me. And if anybody saw me acting up, they didn't just wait until my parents showed up. They would call me to the carpet right on that spot and say, Ralph is acting a fool up in here. And I want to correct it. And when your daddy gets here, I'm going to tell him I corrected you. And he's going to correct you again. Why? Because I was part of a time when people didn't just pass the buck. Oh, that ain't my child. I just look the other way. So we have to come to a place where we accept responsibility and say, if it's in my path to make things better, I'm going to take this opportunity to be salt and to do something to change this situation. I'm going to take this opportunity to be a light. I'm not now just talking to mamas. I'm talking to daddies and everybody else in here. Because we all need to get to a place where we assume the position that if God put me in this situation, if he allowed my eyes to witness this situation, he has brought me to this place for a purpose, and more importantly, he has equipped me to do something about it, because I've got something in me that the world needs. The Jesus in you. So let me get back to mom for a minute. Mom, sometimes you got to do things that nobody else even wants to do.
Amen.
So you learned early. You learned very early, even without the instruction manual, Emmanuel. You learned very early that sometimes your child will make a mess. I was a little angel. I got the floor. I can talk about myself. I was an angel. Oh yeah. I was an angel. But even when you have a child that doesn't intentionally set out to do wrong, sometimes your child will make a mess of things. In fact, sometimes, at some stage, your child will even make a mess on themselves.
Yes. Yes.
Now, mothers, you may have some friends that tell you, oh, let me just hold little Johnny. He's so lovely. Oh, let me just pat little Johnny. But little Johnny makes a mess on himself. Oh, let me give you little Johnny back. Now, when little Johnny was clean and smelled real good, you wanted to hold on little Johnny, didn't you? But mothers know there's something Mothers see what others don't see. Mothers will do what others will not. But I think what's most significant is not what you see, it's not what you do, but it's what you feel that makes you a treasure. What do you mean, Bishop? Mothers have the kind of love that most parallels the love of God.
Amen.
None of us here has the same love that God has. But if you want to see as close as you can get to that kind of love, you find someone who takes their role as a mother seriously. And you will see in that person something called agape. Agape love,
thank you,
is
Lord,
a love that means it's unconditional. It is a love that is without merit. It is a love that comes irrespective of whether the love comes back. It is that kind of love that God has for us. You want to understand that kind of love? Then maybe you should remember John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now that is the gospel. Give. I believe the greatest gift of all is the gift that is described in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Paul says, you can desire many kinds of gifts. Chapter 13. But you ought to desire the greatest gift, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which is the gift of love. Let me tell you about this love. This is the kind of love that is so powerful that it will cause you to go to the extent of sacrificing for your own pleasures just to make certain that the one that you love is taken care of. It's what you feel that drives your actions. We've all heard of a man named Solomon. He was wise. In fact, the Bible describes him as one of the wisest people ever to live. The wisdom didn't come from man, but it came from God as a gift from God. In fact, the Bible teaches us, if you desire wisdom, ask it of God. He was wise. Early in his kingship, as he was adjudicating a conflict, one of the things kings did in those days is that they resolved conflict. There was a woman who came to him screaming, saying, my child has been kidnapped. My child has been kidnapped. This woman over here has him. My child has been kidnapped. This woman over here has stolen my child. Solomon then, after hearing that, adjudicating the conflict, it goes to the other woman. She's holding the child. And the other woman who's holding the child said, no! She lies! This is my child. She fell asleep last night. She rolled over, suffocated her child. And now she's trying to get my child. This is my child. It's not hers. Solomon looks now the first woman and says, "Is this true? You fell asleep and rolled over on your child? Now you're trying to take this other woman's child? What's wrong with you? What do you think I am?" She says, "Wait a minute, King! Let me tell you the whole story. I didn't want to admit this to you, but let me tell you the whole story. There's a famine. There's no food. Me and this woman, we entered into an agreement. But because there was no food and we were getting ready to starve to death, that yesterday we would sacrifice our children. She would sacrifice hers. We would eat the child. Tomorrow, we would sacrifice mine. I know this is horrible, King, but we're dying. We can't live." So we did sacrifice her child. But during the night, she's taken my child. And she's not willing to fulfill her bargain. She's stolen my child from me. So Solomon now looks at the woman with the child and says, "Is this true?" "No, that's not true. No way! This is my child! This is my child! And I'm not willing to give him up!" Mm-hmm. Solomon then says, "I know how to settle this.
Yeah.
Give me the child. Sentry, give me your sword. This is what I'll do. Since neither one of you is willing to admit the truth, this is what I'll do. I will cut the child in half and give each of you a part. That ought to satisfy you." The woman here who's holding the child says, "Yes! Give her the child.